In this video, we're going to run through a preliminary airfoil selection process. Let's get to it. The first step of choosing an airfoil to use for an aircraft would be looking at what is available already. Right, so there is plenty of literature out there that you can peruse and try and find a particular shape that would work for your flight conditions, and that's what we're going to start with here. The idea being is we don't want to take the time or necessarily the money it would take to develop an airfoil from scratch if there's one that works pretty well that's already been developed and already been tested. Now, later, after we do an initial analysis of the performance of our glider, we may choose to either re-choose a different airfoil or maybe shape this airfoil, you know, tweak it a little bit here and there to try and get a little bit better performance out of it. So some of the literature that I went to look for an airfoil was this book called Summary of Low-Speed Airfoil Data. In that book, they had a few different airfoil groups that they were examining, and so we're going to look at some of the free flight model airfoils that they took a look at in this book. You can see there are five here listed. For those of you not familiar with the term free flight, I've got a Wikipedia definition here. I know in school they tell us not to use Wikipedia, but the definition here isn't too bad. It says that free flight is the segment of model aviation involving aircraft with no active external control after launch. The competitive objective being to build and launch a self-controlling aircraft that will consistently achieve the longest flight duration over multiple competition rounds. Right, and that's kind of matching our description for a hand-thrown glider. So we're going to take a look at this book and see what it says about these five different airfoils, and then make a choice at the end of the video on what airfoil we want to initially choose for our preliminary design. We're first going to take a look at the airfoil A18 and MA409. It has a couple paragraphs here that I pulled from the book, speaking of the two of them. And the part that I really liked when looking at these is this that I've circled here in red. It says, in F1C competition, there's a trade-off between the climb and glide. A mediocre climb can be offset by an excellent glide and vice versa. Although the A18 might not launch as high as the MA409, with all else being equal, the A18 probably makes up for this climb handicap in glide performance. Now, since we're doing a hand-launched glider and the climb is going to be a short duration and the glide is going to take up most of the time of our launch, I decided that based on this paragraph, if I had to choose between the A18 and the MA409, I would choose the A18. Now let's look at what it says about some of the other airfoils. I went ahead and pulled out this paragraph speaking about the BE-50, and what stood out to me is this last paragraph that says, thus the BE-50 might be less sensitive to trim changes in glide as compared with the A18 and the MA409 airfoils, which exhibit a more peaky performance. Now that actually makes me want to choose the BE-50 over the A18. Because as a hand-launched glider, there's going to be some variations in how you throw it, and there could be variations in any of the gusts that it encounters. And so potentially having it less sensitive to some of those trim changes or some of those gusts might be better overall performance of the glider, whereas the A18 might give some really good throws and then some really crappy throws. So I'm going to go ahead and switch to the BE-50 as the airfoil that I think I want to use. But let's take a look at those other ones. So here's something that talks a little bit about the GM-15. Now, it's kind of an interesting one that it explains here is that it's a flapper airfoil. And basically it sounds like this airfoil is designed to be a little bit compliant, where it says it is reflects into a lower camber and climb and unflapped in higher camber and glide. I'm not sure how well that's gonna translate into the median we're using to 3D print our glider. So I'm not really liking the GM-15 based on some of what I read and looking at some of the plots. So I'm just gonna go ahead and stick so far with the BE-50. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the NACA 6409. Okay, looking at the NACA 6409, it's kind of hard to get an idea of how this airfoil is going to perform. They made it a little bit differently than the other ones. And so there was some sagging of the airfoil shape when they were doing some of their tests. And it might have messed with some of the air bubbles on the back, or it might have messed with some of the drag. I mean, they even in the book, as you see here in the bottom paragraph, recommend doing additional testing if you're wanting a little bit more accurate values with it. So it's kind of hard to figure out what performance this might have, and it looks like it would be more work because I'm going to have to do some analysis or testing to try and figure out a little bit more accurate data. So based on this, I would choose to stay with the BE50 over the NACA 6409, but there are always other considerations that need to be taken into account. For instance, one of the other things we might look at is the method that we're using to manufacture our airfoil. Namely, we're going to be 3D printing this airfoil shape, and so we might run into a potential problem. So if you look at the trailing edge of many of these flaps, they start to get pretty thin near the back edge. And since we're going to be doing 3D printing, it doesn't always work when you start getting thin like that. And so, even though I think the performance of the BE50 would be better due to just manufacturing considerations, I think I'm actually going to go ahead and choose the NACA 6409 because as you look towards the trailing edge, it's a little bit thicker. I'm thinking it's going to print better. However, at a later time, maybe after the initial analysis, if it's determined that I need something that performs a little bit better, I may look at choosing a different airfoil or maybe adjusting this airfoil shape slightly to get that better performance. And I'm not worried so much about the additional testing required. Part of the initial analysis is that I'm going to do a quick analysis in another software called Xfoil and determine how this one is expected to behave. But that will be a future video. I'm going to go ahead and end this video here. In the next video, we're going to look at an initial fuselage design. I'll see you in the next video.